Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Mashallah, I'm out here in Orange County. I love Orange County. Long history with this beautiful community. And one of my favorite places to go to in Orange County is Jarir Bookstore. I love this place. I live in this place whenever I come here, mashallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Mashallah, good to see you. How you doing? Sharaft. Nice to see you. Thought we would come by and visit one of my favorite places always to come to.
You always welcome, you know.
Jazakallah khair.
You always welcome.
Allah yakramakum. We're just going to look around and see what happens. Barakallahu feek. Jazakallah khair. Thank you.
So, what I've seen, people ask me all the time about istikhara. And they ask me, like, what are the things that are most concerning that you see outside of knowing how to do it properly? And I would say there are like two things that I find people kind of fail to understand. Number one is istikhara, the prayer asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to choose something for us, is not made, for example, with the obligatory things. Like, you don't make istikhara to like pray fajr. You don't make istikhara to like spend time with your family. The second is we don't make istikhara in the areas of the sunnah or the haram, or the impermissible. Why? Because we have rulings for those things. There's clarity there. Istikhara comes in the face of ambiguity, which means in the face of the mubahat, the permissible, as mentioned by Imam Al-Aini. So when am I making istikhara on issues that are permissible for which there is, you know, no clarity, like should I take this job or not, or should I marry this person or not, or should I, you know, take this person as a friend or as a business partner? That's all falling under the permissible issues, and there's why I make listikhara to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second thing that I see people really, I think, this is concerning actually, is that they wait for a dream or some kind of like inner feeling instead of doing the actual research and groundwork to see if that thing is actually good for them, the strategy. Allah says to the Prophet in the Quran, خُذُوا حِذْرَكُمْ, take all the precautions. We know that dreams are important in Islam, but we want to understand that dreams are like milhad al-ta'am, right? Dreams are like salt on the food. They're not the beef. The beef is, I want to marry this person. I want to take this job. I want to, you know, invest in this business. I have to do the research. I have to put in the physical effort, and I have to put in the intellectual rigor to make sure that what I'm doing is correct. These are two mistakes that I see people a lot they make when they talk about istikhara. Number one is they make istikhara for like the wrong things. Like, for example, one time when I was in MSA, we didn't have a khatib, and there was a brother who could give the khutbah. So we said, can you give the khutbah? He's like, I made istikhara, I don't feel good. Yeah, akhi, this is a obligation upon the community to perform, so therefore you have to do it because you're the most qualified. This is not the place for istikhara. The other thing is I see people all the time turn down good opportunities based on dreams or notions. Listen, if I begin to declare the reality of someone else without researching them based on a dream that I had, that means that like I may have a little narcissism in me. Like I think that my dream determines the truth. No. And that's why we oftentimes misunderstand the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, who said that the ru'ya al-sadiqa, the true dreams, are a part of prophethood. And that's why sometimes we misunderstand the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. The problem of the ummah is not that it knows hadith and Quran. The problem of the ummah is that it fails to understand hadith and Quran correctly. This is a bigger catastrophe. So this hadith that says a true dream is a part of revelation, people think, oh, I had a dream, that means it's revelation. No. MashaAllah, Sheikh Abdullah Daraz al-Azhari, one of the great scholars, he said, as Ibn Hajar mentions, if I dream something and later on in life it happens, that's the true dream. Not that I dreamed something and it didn't happen. That's not a true dream. That's not a part of revelation, a part of prophecy. Because we know that the hadith of Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha said that the beginnings of revelation, a part of revelation was what? The true dreams. So he would see it and then later on it would happen. So let's say that I want to take this job, or let's say that somebody wants to marry somebody and they have, oh, I had a bad dream about that person. Did that actually happen, or did you have the dream? If it didn't happen, you should ignore the dream and go based on what you see, the sound research shows. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our istikhara and to help us, inshallah, perform these things correctly, not simply based on passion, which is untethered from religious knowledge. Barakallahu feekum. Wassalamu alaikum.